How many of us see people get rich and get famous and end up right back in the slums where they started because they got so puffed up with pride they forgot that what the universe gave you, the universe would take from you. And then you got the entertainment Negro. These are black folks in Denver with TV shows, radio shows, newspapers, magazines, websites, and they never talk about the real issues. They'll spend a whole show talking about Kanye's coming to town for a concert. The Nuggets made the playoffs. Peyton is back for the first round of the playoffs. They ain't gonna talk about the fact that the Denver Broncos have almost no black folks in the upper management of the control of that team. You understand? They ain't gonna talk about that. They ain't gonna talk about that. We're not gonna talk about police brutality. We're not gonna talk about poor health care. We're gonna talk about nothing except stuff that ain't related to racism. Because the job of the bourgeoisie is to protect the status quo. When you go to break into somebody's house, not that any of you have tried, before you get up to the main house, you don't even get to the house until you deal with the watchdogs. It's the watchdog's job to tear you down before you even get to the steps. That's the job of the bourgeoisie. They guard the door. They are the gatekeepers in Colorado, and their job is to keep black folks powerless, disorganized, and politically stupid long enough for the current governor, mayor, or city council person to live out their term in peace. Because Al Sharpton's job for Obama. Al Sharpton was Obama's HNIC, head Negro in charge. Jesse Jackson was Bill Clinton's. Why didn't Obama use Jesse? Because Jesse no longer has the control over you that he used to have. You found out he was all about his money. So Obama went and got Sharpton. But then black folks figured out Sharpton. When the Baltimore riot popped off, they ran him out. When the brother got shot down in Charleston, South Carolina, they ran Sharpton out and said, we don't want you. So Sharpton no longer has the control of black folk. He can't keep you in your place. So whoever becomes the next president of the United States got to get another HNIC. Who they going to get? Cornell? Michael Eric Dyson? I don't know who they going to get. But they got to find somebody fast. They got to be somebody you respect. They might go to the rap industry and get one of them. But it got to be somebody you respect. This is how they control Negroes. I wish they put me in charge. I'm like, yeah, master, I got the Negroes in charge, man. While they home, we in the White House taking out TVs. Laptops, you're going to rip everything off in the White House. Spray paint the walls. We was here, holla. But some people are incorruptible. Garvey, you couldn't corrupt Garvey, you couldn't corrupt Malcolm, you couldn't corrupt Jesse and I, they were corruptible. See, let me explain something to y'all. If you love anything more than your people's freedom, if you love anything more than your people's freedom, that includes your wife, your children, your house, your career, your job, your quality of life. If you love anything more than your people's freedom, you are a sellout waiting to happen. Because the first thing the white man does is look for your weakness. He loves women. He loves money. She loves power. She loves nice things. And that's the Achilles heel they use to flip you for them, for their purposes. Dr. King's house got blown up twice. They said, if we blow that damn house up with the wife and kids in there, we gonna leave the struggle. Dr. King said, no, I'm back again. That's right. He told Coretta, are you sure you built for this? Because I ain't giving it up. Malcolm looked at Betty. I know this is more than you're bargaining for, Betty, but I was sent here to do this. Can you handle? And I'm saying this to the sisters because some of y'all want a revolutionary type of a brother. But I don't know if y'all really understand just what that means. And some of you brothers want revolutionaries.
and I ain't too strong, y'all know what that means. Yeah. Hell, you're gonna lose everything you got doing this work.
You gotta be willing to part with everything, including your life, on the cross.
Dr. King wanted to die, but he loved you more than his life. Malcolm knew he would die,
but he loved black freedom more than his life. And he kept on keeping on. That's when we have the real men. And we need the Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey Academy to make real men.
Backs don't break.
So we talked about the status Negro, the finance Negro, the higher ed Negro, the entertainment Negro. This is one we ain't touched. And he's the most critical of the five. The religious Negro.
Oh, I knew it.
I'm not talking about this church, and I ain't talking about that reverend. But in your church, they got a funny habit of brainwashing you into thinking your problems will get better without you having to do anything but pray and pay your damn tithes. I got some news for y'all. When you study religious history, I don't care if it's the mosque, the church, the synagogue, the temple, religion has always been the tool of the oppressor. Once in a while, you get a Dr. King coming out the church. Once in a while, you get a Malcolm coming out the mosque. But study history, black history, white history, Irish history, East Indian history. The first thing the oppressor does is go to the church to make sure that pastor can keep the flock under control. Just wait on Jesus long enough. Yeah. And then that white Jesus, y'all gotta get rid of that. Yeah. Yeah. You raise a black child on a white Christ.
Come on, buddy.
And then expect him to be proud to be black. Listen, color matters. If your deity looks like your enemy, you ain't interested in freedom. Listen, the brain is an associated organism. If I go to Sunday school from the age of one, and I pray white Jesus, I see white Jesus in the Bible, it's on the wall, it's everywhere I go. The brain associates and generalizes. So if I grew up on white Jesus, white God, guess what? By the time I'm 8 or 9, I begin to generalize the qualities of white Christ to all white people. And then racism begins to make sense to me. Maybe the judge is white because Jesus is white. Maybe the president is white because Jesus is white. Maybe the police kill black men and get away with it because some of the power of white God might extend to all white people. That's why when you go home tonight, you have to tear down any white pictures in your house. Not for hatred. It is not about hating nobody. The reason you cannot have white images in your home is because black children are going to be bombarded with images of white folk their entire life. They live in a white state and a white city. So your house, they must be Africanized in your house. And if you're not Africanizing your children, then you are Europeanizing your children. It's either one or the other. Gotta teach self-love. I had a mother say, Dr. Johnson, I understand all that, but I let my daughter play with all dolls. She got white dolls, Latino dolls, but you're messing up. But why is that a problem? Because she wanna see the white and Latino worship all in school, all on TV, all on the radio. She don't need it in her house. So you mean to tell me you hate yourself so much that you wanna share time with other people who don't care about your daughter? Teaching her to love them more than herself. All of your son's dolls better look like him. And if you can't find them, we coming out with a Prince of Pan-Africanism doll. Give them back! And guess what? I got some, what they call them? Protagonists? I got some antagonists. You know the enemies who fight me? And all my haters in the conscious community will have their own doll!
have y'all down. And the dog will be just as ugly as you hate it.
Brothers and sisters, in order for you to understand racism, you need to understand Willie Lynch. Willie Lynch. Some people argue over whether he existed or not. I don't know if he did. I don't even care. Because it's not about the historical accuracy of the Willie Lynch letter. It's about the scientific validity of the principles therein. When you read the Bible, every story in the Bible is not to be taken literally. It's the allegorical truth that's being taught. We African people, do you realize our whole culture is based on telling the truth through a fairy tale? And why do we do that? Because sometimes you have to create a story to convey your message, because there isn't a story in existence that can do it properly. Now, Willie Lynch taught a lot of things, but I'm going to focus your attention on three. The first thing he said, if you want to control your slaves in Colorado, the first thing you must do is teach them to never use their own native tongue when they communicate. Willie Lynch said they must always communicate through your tongue, never their own. And the slave master said, why? And Willie Lynch said, because if they still talk Igbo, Zulu, Yoruba, Twi, Swahili, it will remind them that they had a history before you took them. This is why they don't want black kids talking Ebonics. Listen, Colorado. Your child does not speak broken English. They speak Niger Congo African dialect. The only thing your child borrows from English is the vocabulary words. Now let me break this down.
Break it down, man.
There's different parts to a language. There's the morphology, there's the grammar, there's the syntax, there's the structure. There's the rhythm, there's the phonology, there's the vernacular. Religion is not the sum total of the words that you use. In fact, if you go to West Africa, and you could go with me this summer, I'll get to that in a minute, you will notice that our brothers and sisters on the continent talk just like we do. The only difference is they do not use English vocab. They use African vocab. But the structure, the syntax, the grammar, the rhythm, the system is the same. Let me illustrate this. Because I know you got some bourgeois Negroes in here who are saying, I cannot believe he telling these parents that their kids are not talking English. Listen, bourgeois. No, this is important. Let me tell you what the bourgeois Negro's problem is, and I know because I work with him. I was supposed to be one, but I jumped off that boat. Listen, the bourgeois problem, they think that racism exists because black people don't know how to act white enough. Stay with me. In other words, if your son spoke standard English, if he listened to rock and roll, if he went to school with a three-piece suit on, if he wore skinny jeans every day, are y'all following me? If he learned how to act like a white man, then racism will leave him the hell alone. You don't realize white people don't object to the rap. They control the rap. They don't object to the clothes. They control the clothes. They don't object to anything because they created all the circles. They object to the fact that your son exists in the first place. Look at Bill Cosby. Here's a man who made a living making white folks smile. The number one black comedian and entertainer until Richard Pryor and then Eddie Murphy. Bill Cosby made